request everyone to stay on mute while we do this. We are going to actually do this session over sections, and there will be ample opportunity for everyone to actually interact with each other. So in the first section, we'll cover what is the sandbox, what are the entities in the NDHM ecosystem, and you will be hearing these terms like health information provider, health repository provider, health information. Many of you might have already received an access key, and for some the processing is still underway. So we will talk about how you can actually use that. In the second section, we'll understand a bit more about health IDs and about issuing health IDs. And in the third section, we will talk about how at a health facility, a health ID must be captured, how can it be verified, what is a linking token, and how and when to link records with the consent manager. And we'll get into a bit of the APIs that are required for actually capturing and verifying of these records. And finally, in the last section, we will basically do a quick demo of the reference apps, specifically the PHR app and the EMR web app, which will be quite useful as also as tools for each of you to get your own integration going. And lastly, we will talk about how you can actually get support from NDHM for any technical issues. Now, this is an interactive session, and we will encourage you to ask questions. You will see a raise hand feature in Teams. We'll request you to raise hand if there are any queries, and we will try to answer queries at the end of each section that we have. Now, before we get started, it's important to understand how NDHM is looking to actually redefine the hospital experience. So in the future, when many of you have integrated with NDHM, we hope that when a patient walks up to a hospital, they can actually see something like a QR code pasted on the registration desk. You would pull out your smartphone, launch any one of the PHR apps that are available in the market, and you could scan the code, and the hospital would actually instantly get details about the patient, especially their health ID, their name, age, gender. So we actually hope to make the whole registration process smoother and faster.
Yaar, ye meeting mein awaaz kyun nahi aa rahi?
Request everybody else to go on mute.
Haan, isi mute pe hu main. बंदे की आवाज ही नहीं आ रही. तो ठीक.
The Sukrit, can you confirm you can hear me? Yeah, thanks. So the hospital would send a consent request to the patient, requesting access to the medical history of the patient, and then the patient would choose what data, health data, they would want to share with the hospital, for how long the hospital can access. And when, by the time the patient walks into the doctor's consulting room, the doctor would be able to see the full medical history open on the computer. And if, as part of the treatment, they basically provide a prescription or a clinical notes, those would be actually notified, and the patient would be able to access them on their phone and never lose the history again. So this is what NDHM hopes to do. It's one of the many things that NDHM hopes to do. And much of today's discussion will feature around getting started with this process. So today we are only going to cover a couple of bits of this process, which is what are these health IDs? How can I actually capture them in the hospital? How can I kind of save them? And in future sessions, we will cover other things, including, you know, what is a consent request? What's a consent object? How do I actually share information securely between entities? Now, the whole process of the National Digital Health Mission, we have split it into two parts, one called the sandbox process, which many of you are already aware of because you have applied. And essentially, the sandbox process is a way for NDHM to make sure that software that is integrating with the APIs actually have done a proper job of meeting all of the obligations. And then we will provide access. Once you have finished this, you will then provide access to the actual production NDHM environment. So many of you have probably sent the request. Several of you have got access. We have received over 230 applications to the sandbox to date, and I think we have finished processing about 150 of those applications. There are several applications which are actually incomplete, and some of those which are incomplete will get an email saying that they will need to probably reapply to the sandbox. Those applications that have been successfully processed would have already got an client ID and access key by email, which will enable them to get to step three, which is to start integrating with the APIs. Once you're done, right now we do have a showcase to NHA because we are in the very early days. We want to understand how various private players are able to actually leverage this for delivering very interesting and innovative applications. There is a certification process. At this point, we are still working on how would the certification process work, but essentially we are looking to have a few agencies empaneled, which can actually, you can submit your application to, and they would verify that it is compliant to the API requirements and the security requirements, and then allow you to actually go live on NDHM. Now, let's spend a bit of time to understand what are the building blocks that are available as part of NDHM. So what you see in the middle, the NDHM building blocks consists of five blocks that have been released as part of phase one. These consist of the Health ID, the Consent Manager and Gateway, DigiDoctor, which in future will actually evolve to a Health Workforce Registry, and the Facility Registry. We have also developed three reference applications. On the left side, we have developed a reference application which talks about how would a hospital or a diagnostic center or a clinic essentially build an EMR or a web app in which it can share health data. Health data on the National Digital Health Mission is shared in a standardized format called an FHIR format. So there are specific NDHM profiles share health data. And we have also built a reference app called the NDHM PHR app, which is an app on which as a consumer you can view your health records. And we are in the process of developing something called the NDHM Health Locker. So a health locker is an entity that actually helps users, it's a save a personal copy of their own records in a long-term personal storage. So it works usually quite closely with the PHR application in terms of its controls. So the hospital diagnostic center or the clinic, which is actually generating the health information in the NDHM world, is called a health information provider. The software that usually supports the hospital to keep these records digitally and keep them in long-term storage is called a health repository provider. And any service that is trying to access the health information in a standardized format is called a health information user. So these are terminologies that NDHM uses, and each of these come with certain responsibilities and APIs. While NDHM has built reference applications, the idea really is to have a whole ecosystem of software that is, you know, provisioned for hospitals and labs to be compliant with NDHM, many different mobile applications that can actually provide health or health-based services to users, as well as multiple health locker service as part of the overall ecosystem. So everything that you see as building blocks has been deployed by the National Health Authority as both production and also as part of the sandbox environment. So in the sandbox environment, you will not only be able to access these building blocks, but also all of the reference applications. The sandbox environment is primarily the place where all of you will actually come in to integrate with these building blocks. And while reference applications have been built to demonstrate the capabilities of the building blocks, it is by design that we expect that the market will then actually use that to learn and actually provide multiple and much more innovative options to the overall ecosystem. Almost everything that you see on this slide is currently ready, except for the NDHM locker service. The specifications for the locker as well as the reference service is expected to be published by early 2020. Getting into a little more into what is the definitions of a health information provider, health information user, or a health repository provider. Like we said in the previous diagram, a health information provider is anyone who creates a health information in the context of treating a patient and then agrees to share it digitally using the NDHM framework. So for example, a health facility, if it merely registers with the National Digital Health Mission's health facility registry, does not become a HIP. It has to explicitly say that I am willing to share data digitally with my patients, and that's when it really becomes a HIP. A health repository provider is actually the software that holds these health records. So health records are almost always held very close to the, you know, in the health information provider decides which health repository he would like to use to hold their records in. And these records need to be held from a long-term storage perspective. So we expect health repository providers to hold health records for users digitally for decades. And health information users are entities that get access to these health records with consent. And they are expected to essentially obey the norms specified in the consent for how long, what's the purpose for which they're getting access to the data, how long they can have access to that data. So both mobile applications that are trying to access health data, or even a doctor's view where you're trying to display the history of a patient, would essentially be a health information user and would need to meet whatever is the guidelines specified by the consent artifact when they get access to the health data. So getting a little more into what these building blocks are, the health ID is essentially the service by which one can digitally identify themselves in a health transaction. So all users who wish to get records digitally on their device are expected to get themselves a health ID. Every health ID is actually linked with just one consent manager. Right now, there is only one consent manager in the ecosystem, which is the NDHM consent manager. We are looking at the process for establishing more consent managers soon in the ecosystem, but we would like to start with the first consent manager that has been set up by NHA. The consent manager itself is an entity that holds an index of where the health records are. So it knows that for this health ID, all of these health repository providers have some portion of that user's data. And it also tracks which all HIUs have been given access or have been revoked access for health data that has been shared. And there are a whole bunch of APIs which essentially help the ecosystem to either link content or share content between HIPs and HIUs. The architecture is such, and this federated architecture is such, so that the consent manager or the gateway itself does not have access to any health data. So health data either resides at a health repository provider chosen by the HIP, or can sit in your health locker chosen by the user, or can be on a device which is a HIU based on the consent of the user. The DigiDoctor and facility registries are basically registries. So doctors can actually enroll themselves in DigiDoctor and be verified. And essentially you will get a bunch of APIs by which doctors can either identify them digitally, say in a telemedicine-like application, or to e-sign documents. The ability to enroll is already on for the UTs, and the APIs for DigiDoctor will be shared shortly. So facility registry is similar. Again, it's been launched and facilities can register themselves and get verified. and a registration of a facility is a must to participate in NDHM so that we know that genuine facilities are creating health records. A unique facility ID will be issued, and we are looking at how registration in a health facility would actually improve ease of doing business in terms of faster empanelment. And so APIs will also be released for this in early October 2020. The NDHM architecture, as we discussed, is a federated architecture. And so on the left side, whether it's a public health program, a large hospital, we expect them to essentially implement both the HIP and HRP specifications and essentially store and hold data within their own ecosystem and softwares for sharing with the NDHM system. Whereas smaller diagnostic centers and clinics are expected to essentially use, say, maybe hosted solutions. So a single HRP could support multiple HIPs and hold their data and actually share them from the architecture perspective. On the right side, you see again, anybody who wants to access data would be called a HIU and would essentially make requests for data to the consent manager, and then on obtaining consent from the user would be able to fetch or would be able to get all of the data from the various HRPs that are holding the data. A copy of the users can decide to set up a health locker, and a copy of their data, all of the data from across HRPs, would be stored in their own personal copy in the health locker. Health lockers would also be the place where users can upload their own data. So if people wanted to scan certain records and upload it, or if they had certain information that's coming from IoT connected devices, all of those would go into the health locker and then would be enabled for sharing in the ecosystem. So health lockers are specialized services that act as both health repository providers on behalf of the user as well as HIUs in the overall system. So in order to identify the various entities in the NDHM ecosystem when we are dealing with all of these APIs, we essentially have come up with a process. Anyone who wants to be a health repository provider or implement a HIU or a health locker, we will be issuing a client ID and client secret. Right now, what has been issued is the client ID and client secret for the sandbox. So there will be a similar thing that will be issued once you have certified yourself for production. And all such entities need to identify themselves using and register a public URL so that we know which is the endpoint for communication. So the communication between the gateway as well as a HRP or a HIU always happens through these endpoints, and it is up to the software to register a public URL which will act as the endpoint. Since a single organization can actually, you know, sell their software and have multiple instances installed, a single organization can obtain multiple client IDs, and usually they will obtain it for each endpoint that they would like to kind of register in the ecosystem. For now, only registered health facilities can become HIPs. If there are other scenarios or other entities who need to become HIPs, you know, we would request you to write to us so that we can look at who else are interested in becoming health information providers. And the process is to have the verification to be done by the registering facility through the health facility registry, which is at facility.ndhm.gov.in. And once that is approved, the health facility will be able to say which is the health repository provider it plans to use to manage its health records, so that we establish the link. So we're going to just show you with a quick demo on APIs in the sandbox as to how can you achieve exactly all of this with the set of APIs and keys that we have sent you. And we will also take questions right after that. So Sukrit, I'm going to stop sharing my screen. If you can show the sandbox page and also the demo of how to use their access keys.
Yes, sure, Siren. So let's start with the sandbox website. So I think this is a sandbox website, because from here you have registered. And after registering, everyone would have received the client ID and a secret from NDS. So let's see what to do once you have received the client ID and a secret. So the go to documentation.
Sukrit, can you tell us how to get the client ID, client secret?
Okay, sure. So basically, if you see here, there's a send request page. If you click on that button, there's a form that you need to fill up and submit. Okay. Once you submit this information, we will be receiving receiving the request, and it will be, you know, prioritized, and you will be given access. Like once it's approved, we will be sending you an email with the client ID and the secret.
Okay.
So the fields that we need are organization name, what you are, and you know, nature of the income organization, the registered address. Okay, and in context of the sandbox environment, whether you want to be an HIP or an HIU or both, you have to choose.
Okay.
Is it okay? Shall I move on to what happens after you receive a client ID and a secret?
Just a minute. This URL that you are supposed to give.
Yeah.
Is it that endpoint URL that was just now talked about, or it is URL of our company?
Which URL are you talking about? Here, in means website. No. This is just a website of your company. The endpoint URL is something you can update once you have got your client ID and passkey.
Thanks, Sukrit.
Yeah. So on the left side, or like if you go to documentation, on the left side you see implementer's guide, and the last thing in this topic is getting started with the APIs. Okay. So here we have. So basically, in order to do any actions with the client ID, with the access key and the token that you receive, you need to first get a session ID or an access token. Okay. And you need to initiate the session with our gateway. So the URL is here, which you can use with a client ID and a passkey. So all you need to do is copy this curl, import it into your Postman or wherever you want to use, and use your client ID and passkey in the body. So update the values. So I'll go here. So you can just import it, paste that. So this is imported. Now I need to put in a valid client ID and a passkey in the body. So I'll use something that I have here. So once I hit this, I get an access token. Now this access token is given to you. This is valid for 300 ms, so 5 minutes. Okay. And using this access token, you need to make the subsequent calls. Okay. Let's have a look at what we have here. So here you see the structure is this, the main access token, and then you have additional information like when it expires and other things like where. So next is updating your health repository URL. This is the point that Kiran was mentioning as the endpoint URL. Okay. So once you have received your access token, you need to hit this curl with the URL of your organization. Again, the same thing. So all you need to do is go to your Postman or whatever you guys use, import this curl. Okay. Now see, in the body, it just accepts a URL. Okay. And in the header, it accepts a bearer token. Right. So this is the token you need to use from the sessions API that you have received. So essentially this token.
Sorry to interrupt. Just a basic question on this API you're talking about. What's the purpose of this exactly?
So the purpose of this API is just to update the endpoint URL. So if you have seen the architecture, or if not, I'm sure we will talk about it sometime. So all our APIs are asynchronous APIs. So the system behaves in a way where when you call one API, it just says, okay, your request has been accepted, but it doesn't give you the actual response that you are looking for. And then asynchronously, we make a callback to your system, giving you back the response that you want, you were expecting.
Okay, so that means our URL has to sort of implement some sort of contract APIs. Yes. That you define.
Yes, exactly. Okay. Okay. So Kiran, can I just talk about that for 2 minutes, or will you be covering it later?
No, please go ahead.
Sure. So if you check this sandbox documentation, in the implementer's guide, there are these sections saying building HIP and building HIUs. Okay. So let's assume if you're building an HIP, this has the flow diagrams and all, and there is a link to a Swagger documentation, which gives the contract or what are the APIs that you need to expose on top of that URL. Also, you need to make sure these APIs are public, in the sense our system can access them because we are going to call them back. Does that answer your question?
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, got it.
Right. So before calling the NDHM APIs and waiting for the response, these APIs should be implemented in our URL on our side.
Yes.
Okay, great. Thanks.
And these structs is very, the Swagger is quite well defined, like it gives you.
Yeah.
Question here, can we implement it later, as it, or we can maybe as part of the implementation?
So as a part of the implement, in order to receive the callbacks, okay, mm-hmm. you need to expose this API. Now, for the timing, maybe to start with, you can just log the response on your system so that you know that you're getting some response.
Mm-hmm.
Otherwise,
because there was a confirmation asked, like whether this APIs are getting executed or not with the secret key and ID. In the mail, it was asked like that we should confirm back and respond at whether the integration is working or not. So we can use any of, let's say, one API, let's say user auth, and try it, and then implement rest of the ones which is according to the needs, right?
I think if you can just verify that you're able to get a session token using Postman, that will be good enough.
Okay. Thank you, Kiran.
So
another thing is that, is it a base URL, right?
Sorry?
Is it a base URL?
So the base URL is the link that you are sending here. Say in this API, you are using this URL, right? Here you give the base URL. On top of this base URL, you have to implement these APIs.
Okay.
Wait, I have a question.
Yes, please.
So you mentioned that APIs needs to be public. So which API you are referring here, which needs to be public?
Public in the sense, say, as a HIP, you will implement some APIs, right?
No, one second. Great. So basically the endpoint URL has to be reachable from our gateway, because when the gateway is trying to do a callback, it needs to be able to resolve your URL or your endpoint. So essentially you need to provide us a, when you set up with this particular API, when you register your health repository provider URL, it needs to be something that's accessible from our gateway. That's what we mean when we say a public URL.
So is there a sequence diagram or something that might appear up here?
Yes. There are detailed sequence diagrams for everything. You will find them in the documentation. Sukrit, I think we should take some of these questions specifically, because there are a lot of people who have raised hands. So yeah. Why don't you just finish the two steps and then we will come back to this, because there's, you know, for a lot of them, there's a lot to learn and discover, and let's go step by step.
Sure. Yeah. So I think first step is getting the session token. And once you have the session token, you need to update the endpoint URL, which is the base URL, which should be accessible from our gateway. Any questions on this, or shall I move on to the next step?
Sir, I had a question on, am I audible?
Yes.
I had a question on the endpoint URL that we are talking about here.
Let's say using an instance hosted on AWS. As of now, AWS is not providing any TLS certification for any instances hosted, apart from the things which are hosted in North Virginia. For example, if I use something in Mumbai, so would this endpoint URL accept HTTP, or it needs to be HTTPS for in order to get the callback?
So HTTPS is absolutely, you know, because from a security and the fact that we are going to actually be exchanging data on it is a requirement. But you can write to us. I would like to understand a bit more about what is the restriction that is there on AWS for it. And then we'll see what's the way we can handle that.
AWS.
Let's take it offline. I understand that you're saying there's some concern on AWS. Request we take that on an email or offline, and we'll continue with the session. Sukrit, we have a time ticker also running, so please move to the next step.
So the next step is where you register a facility with your repository. So now the client ID passkey, if you think, remember the diagram that we were showing before, represents the repository or a bridge. Now, under that bridge, you need to add a health HIP or HIU or both based on what you are implementing. So let's copy the curl and I'll import the curl here. Okay. So if you see this curl, it's a dev service that we have exposed for now, which gives you the ability to add your own HIPs to play around. So if you go to the body, I'll beautify the body. See, you can choose things like an unique ID. So let's put something, say, demo 101. Okay. A facility name, say, demo again. Facility type should be HIP, active is true. And some alias, which is like something with which you can search your demo. So I can just put demo for now, this doesn't really matter. And in the header, again, the bearer token should be the access token. I'll regenerate it because probably this had expired in 5 minutes. With this, if I hit, I get a 200 okay. That means I have successfully registered my HIP against the bridge. Okay. Any concerns, questions here? Okay, we move on.
Yeah, so I had one query. So the unique ID in this that you entered would be something from our side, nothing from your side, like the client ID that you send, nothing like that.
Actually, no, one second. Sukrit, if you can stop sharing, I'll just share back my presentation. Just going back to, I think this is an important construct. If you reread this, for the last step in production, it has to be a verified facility. So whenever a facility is registered on facility.ndhm.gov.in, a unique facility ID is actually provided. So the first step of where he put in demo would actually be a facility ID, and then the facility would actually say which HRP. So in this case, you know, you were registering it against a HRP. So that would actually be done through the facility registry. So we will take, there are a few people who have raised hands. So I'm just going to use this to, if there are any specific questions related to the architecture itself, we'll start with Amit on the top. We can go to, yeah, waiting on Amit. Can we go to Subhash? Can we go to Runak Pradhan?
Hi. So essentially, I have two questions. First is around Hello, am I audible?
Hello.
Yeah. So first question was around the facility registry. Say if we all so first when are these expected to be made live, and what is the process of verification of these facility IDs?
Yeah.
Because now if we are starting to store EMR records and there is a facility which say we have partnered with, and there is the same facility is coming in as a record from say another provider. How does the due diligence of facility IDs happen?
No. So every facility is anything which has a physical presence. So every facility is supposed to uniquely register with the health facility registry. It's already live. You can see it at facility.ndhm.gov.in. Right now it's open for registration for only facilities in the union territories, but it should be open for registration nationwide shortly. So the verification is something which the district administration will basically just verify that it's an actually valid facility. The details are available on facility.ndhm.gov.in.
Okay, so if we have say a list of facilities which we have already onboarded, can we use this API to register them as well?
The facility API, yes, you can. Once the facility registry APIs are available, right now we have not yet published the facility registry APIs. Apart from going to facility.ndhm.gov.in, any of you will also be able to help a facility onboard using the facility registry APIs.
Okay. And my second question was around the consent manager. So essentially, if we have say a PHR, if we have say a health vault which is already in place, first and foremost is registering that health vault onto the NDHM ecosystem. Second is like for accessing records from this health vault itself, do we need to go in through consent manager implementation, or we can enable records to be accessed through our health vault without having consent?
So the health locker is a standard specification, and it will need to go through the consent manager. If you are doing something which is private between two entities, that is out of scope. But if you are implementing to the standard, it will require to go through the consent manager. Thanks, Ronak. I'm going to move to Sethuraman.
Sure. Thank you. Hey, Karanda. This is from Microsoft. So I had a question. So I'm asking this question as a HRP. And so are there any specific guidelines for registering the PHCs, the district hospitals, SDH, etc. in the government system in the facility registry?
Yes.
And as a HRP, is that something that we'll have to do, or is that something with the appropriate permissions from the government, of course? But is this something as an HRP that all these HRPs are, I mean, all these PHCs are managed through this software? So how does it work?
Yeah, so I think the concept is very simple. The facility decides or indicates which software it is using. So ask the facility to register in the facility directory. Once it is approved from the login of the facility directory, they can say, this is the software that we are using. And they basically have to give the HRP's ID. And essentially, there is a link created. What in the last step you saw as an API call from Sukrit, that essentially will happen in production when the facility says, this is the HRP that I'm using. So all records from this one standpoint will get associated with that facility and HRP. Is that clear, Sethuraman?
Yeah, so just a follow-up question on that is, so the URL would be a single URL for multiple PHCs, if that is that possible, will that work?
That is your implementation. You can decide how many endpoints you want to have. Every endpoint gets a separate client ID and client access. So if you are implementing it in such a way, say that, you know, you need three endpoints, because you have three separate clusters or three instances for which each of them managing X number of facilities, all of that flexibility is absolutely in your hands. Can I move to Gaurav?
One small thing, and is the lab inside a PHC considered as a separate facility?
Yes, basically labs even though they're part of a facility, will get a separate lab ID.
Great, Kiran. Thanks.
Gaurav? Gaurav Pandey?
Yes, sir. These were the questions which have been answered already.
Thank you. And please, anybody whose question has already been answered, please lower your hand. Harshal?
So, hi. Harshal.
Yeah,
you said Harsha or you said something?
Harsha Talreja.
Yeah. Hi. So I had this question. My team actually registered as one of the HIU. So we got this mail. So just as my understanding, if we are able to get the token right now, so integration is complete. Like for now, we can consider that.
You are not yet integrated. I mean, you have a valid token in your hand. You still need to implement all of the APIs.
Yeah, so for that, if I implement all the APIs on my endpoint, then only I will get a response.
That's correct. So you have to start studying for implementing a HIU. There is documentation on the website. So start looking at what that involves. Also play around. We'll show you by the end of the session the sandbox application, which is a reference application which implements a HIU. So take a look at that. And once you understand, you'll be able to do it.
One last thing, the facility registry thing that you told, in production, we will need to have a unique facility ID. So everyone need to register for a facility in that URL that you said, facility.ndhm.com.
Yeah, facilities need to register, not HIUs. So if you're just implementing a viewer of health records, you are not a facility.
Okay.
But typically, anybody issuing a health record is usually a health facility or somebody who's a health information provider. So right now, health information providers get registered through the facility register.
Okay, so HIUs don't need to register. So the unique HIU ID that was required in that postman collection.
So that is going to be, we'll send, share documentation accurately for that. That will be the same as your client ID that has been issued.
Okay, fine. That's good.
XHIP ID will be the same as the client ID.
Okay, understood.
Yeah. Aditya Singh?
Yep. So my question was like, if an HRP is a health locker as well, then will it be allowed to store data from a different HRP if the patient gives the consent?
Yes, that's the idea of a health locker. A health locker is a personal storage chosen by the patient. So technically, if you think about it, I am a patient. Let us say I have visited 5 health facilities. Let's assume that each of these health facilities use different HRPs. So that means different portions of my longitudinal record are sitting in a federated architecture across these 5 health repository providers. But I can say, look, I want to keep a copy of all my records safe in the cloud. So I choose a health locker service, and that health locker service will then get a copy of all of my records and it will keep it. And when I am sharing it with my doctor, I can decide whether I want to share it from my locker or from the HRPs. So if I have a locker, then from only one entity, all the records will go back and get shared with anybody else I'm sharing. I hope that's clear, Aditya.
Yeah, that was good. And like during the registration of a facility, you said they can choose an HRP. Like, will there be an option to select multiple HRP as well?
No, because at any one point, they'll have to decide as to where they're keeping their records. There are processes for migration when you change software or you're moving. But at any point right now, the design allows for only one HRP per facility.
Okay, like I was thinking of specialties might use like different HRP software.
We will have to find ways to register them as multiple HIPs. Needs discussion, but if there is a valid scenario, we request you to write to us and we will consider that.
Sure, thank you.
Just to add on that, Kiran, because see, there will be like different EHRs might be used, let's say ambulatory or inpatient or outpatient. So this might be required, I believe. So
okay,
maybe
it's a good feedback. So we will figure out how in our design we can also make sure that multiple HRPs can then be registered from a single HIP, but for different functions, I presume. So we'll need to know how to differentiate those. We'll definitely think about that. That's good feedback. Padmaraj, I know you're on the call. I suggest you make a note and then we will keep going away. Aditya, go ahead.
Yeah,
last question. So you mentioned like we have to implement those APIs for the contract. I was wondering how will the authentication and authorization work there, since like we will be at the receiving end?
On the authentication and authorization, there are headers that you will see on each of those APIs. Please take a look at them, and I think in a slightly later session we'll have Sukrit show them to you again.
Okay.
Yeah, thanks. Chandrak De?
Yeah. Hey Kiran, I have one question related to implementation of the HIP. So basically, I have seen something like the project takeoff. So they have implemented a couple of they have implemented the HIP and the HIOs, right? And also they have implemented consent manager and then Jata UAP. So let's say if I need to implement that all the APIs which are that specification given in the Swagger documentation, can I start with by downloading the code from the project take and then is it possible, or I need to, I mean, can I get some match between the what has been implemented in the project take and what has been asking for to implement on the HIP side?
Yeah, so project take is basically the open source version of much of the code base that NDHM is also using. So you can definitely look at the HIP and the HIU implementations there. They are almost in sync with the spec. There have been some minor changes to the specifications since I think Project Take was done, but we will try to make sure that the HIP and HIU implementations there are up to date. Yeah, but that's a very good starting point. At this point, I suggest that you try to use the sandbox hosted consent manager and the APIs we are providing for your integration. So pick up the HIP source code or the HIU source code from there, depending on what you're trying to implement.
Yes. Okay. Great. Thanks, Kiran. Yep.
Paul?
Hi. So my question was regarding Sukrit when he was giving a demo. So I was trying to implement the API simultaneously just to get a hands-on. And when I tried, it is giving me in... We have a client ID as well as a client secret, but it's showing me invalid client secret. So that was my question to that.
Okay.
Well, I think you can send it to us on support towards the end if there might be an issue with your client ID and client secret. We'll get that checked out for.
Yeah, okay, no issues, yeah.
Can I go to Pundari Kaksha Mishra?
So my question was that if I am integrating the APIs of NDHM as per documentation of Swagger, so let's say I have two environments, one of my development environment and production environment. So do I need two client IDs and secret keys, or is it...
Yeah. So you are not yet, nobody has been given access to the production environment yet. You will need to go through a certification before production keys are issued for the NDHM network, as I showed in my second slide. So after you have finished your integration, we will ask you to go through a small certification, and post the certification, you can get access to production keys and actually do production deployments.
My question was slightly different. It's not production environment of NDHM, but production environment of my software. Like my software have two instances, one is development and production. So integrating into both environment, integrating API in both environment, do I need two separate client ID and client secrets, or one is sufficient?
Yeah, at this point, given one client ID and client secret, you can only put one endpoint in the whole system. So you'll have to choose which endpoint you want to register.
Okay.
Yeah, thanks. Sunil?
For one endpoint, with one endpoint, I can manage multiple hospitals.
Yes, that's correct.
Hi, my question is about the implementation of PHR or EHR. So if I am registering as an HIU, wherein I am requesting a EHR of a patient, then my understanding is the EHR is going to be stored as a federated record where each of the links to various EMRs are going to be part of the EHR. So I have two part question. One is, When I'm trying to construct the complete EHR on the HIU side or the where the doctor needs to look at the patient record, do I need to make multiple calls to each and every HIP who is basically having the individual EMR components, number one? Number two, each of these EMR going to be sent back to the HIU as a callback URL or a callback from the HIPs?
Yeah, if we are, you're jumping the gun, so recommend that you read the documentation on implementing a HIU. It will, and we will cover it in a later part of the session.
Okay.
We are quite jumping ahead on this question, so I'm going to have to skip this one for the moment.
Sure. As far as it is getting covered, that's okay.
Yeah.
Anuj? Okay, so one simple question was, I was running of consent manager and gateway all in my local. So I was trying to generate my own client ID and client secret. I did that, but it was not running well. So where can I do that for testing purposes in my local?
Look, if you're trying to set up the whole stack from the open source, that's your own call. We are here discussing how to use it in the sandbox environment where we will offer the support. So not the right forum for this. Folks, I know that there are many more questions, but we also have a paucity of time. So I would like to move forward on the
topic. I have a small question. Can I?
Yeah.
Actually, I understood that so whatever we have received, the keys, client key and secret keys for HRP. Okay. And so we have to mention the endpoint for integration. Now, this bundle of this information, that is the fire information, can we test it without exposing this endpoint? Is there any platform where we can validate our fire JSONs?
Yes, FHIR has its own set of validators.
But we have checked that, this has been slightly modified because this is not exactly FHIR version 4.0. There is certain modifications done by this NRC. Okay, so and this is actually, I think, I have a doubt whether it will be validated by this validator.
Yeah, so there is a section in the documentation on this particular thing. So again, we'll jumping the gun, not relevant to this portion of the discussion. So we'll take this either offline through support or we'll point you to the appropriate documentation for this. Folks, I'm going to just continue the next part of the section so that we can go ahead. So we have done the demo and covered some of the queries for section one. So let's get into what do hospital and lab software actually need to implement. So let's say if you are a provider of a hospital or a lab software, the first capability that you need to build is to, when somebody comes and a patient comes to your hospital, the ability for them to get a health ID, and two, the ability in your software to collect and verify health ID. So today's session will focus on just these two items. There are two more things that you need to do, which is you need to implement a HIP service or the health repository service. That is essentially the endpoint that we are talking about. And you need to be able to respond to consented data requests in the appropriate FHIR format. And three, if you want to show or display the health records to your doctor, then you need to be able to create a consent artifact, fetch the health data, and then display that to the doctor. So in today's session, we'll only cover the first part, which is how to issue, what is the process of issuing health IDs, and how to collect and verify health IDs in the in your system. Now there are detailed guidelines. So on the sandbox site, as well as the NDHM website, you will find something called the HIP HIU guidelines document. I request all of you to make sure that you go through the guidelines, because this is what we are expecting you to be compliant to as you implement the HIP and HIU implementations of the specification. Now, anybody who becomes a health information provider essentially has certain obligations. And one of those obligations is that they will assist or help people get a health ID when they come to their facility. Two, that they will capture and verify health IDs from their patients. That they will link health records to the health IDs that they have collected. They will exchange requests of data from the consent manager in the appropriate formats. And they will hold these digital records in long-term storage for both IPD and OPD records. And in scenarios, like somebody was saying, if I want to change my health repository provider, or if I'm going out of business, there are some end situations where they may need to migrate their health data so that it is still available to the patient. And finally, they must share some aggregated as well as anonymized data that is useful for public health purposes. So these are the obligations of anybody who becomes a health information provider. Let us look at what is the process for issuing a health ID and understand a little more bit more about what are health IDs. So a health ID is essentially something that any user must get out of his own voluntary accord to, if he wants to get digital records available with him on, say, on his mobile or in his locker. So the health ID that is being created by the NDHM essentially has two constructs, something that we call as a health ID number. It's a 14-digit random number that is guaranteed to be there on every health ID. And users can also choose for themselves an easy to remember string, which we call the health ID. And the minimal criteria to create a health ID is simply a name, year of birth, gender, along with either a mobile number or an Aadhaar. Either of these two are used as devices or channels by which you can collect and manage consent of the users. So the whole process is completely voluntary, and you can very easily get yourself a health ID through self-registration. So we view two ways in which health IDs could be issued. If people are implementing mobile applications, they can actually create a health ID as part of the mobile application. In fact, the sandbox, the PHR, NDHM PHR application that we will demonstrate later does implement the process of creation of a health ID. There's also the official health ID portal, which is available at healthid.ndhm.gov.in. Right now, issue of health ID is open only to the union territories as part of the current pilot. There is also a sandbox version, which you can also create through the PHR application for creating health IDs that you can play around with. And you can create it with either Aadhaar or a mobile number, like I said earlier. The other way in which health IDs are created is something called as assisted registration. So we are expecting health facilities to actually offer this to their patients, especially for those who are either elderly, illiterate, or even those without mobile phones. Ideally, a separate desk can be set up, or it can be integrated with the existing registration desk at a facility. And in this, we expect the health facility to have the ability to create it using biometric authentication with Aadhaar. So a computer with a biometric scanner and a printer is recommended, and you can just create a health ID by capturing an Aadhaar biometric, doing what we call as an eKYC, and then create a health ID, print it, and issue it to patients as part of your registration process. So when you register and approve a facility on the health facility registry, one of the things that NDHM does is it provides you a capability wherein the facility can start creating health IDs on healthid.ndhm.gov.in. So you can just use this to create the health IDs for patients. In our opinion, EMR or HMIS or LIMS providers, they do not really need to implement the APIs to create health IDs from their own UI. So unless they feel that there is some benefit from a process or a flow perspective, we do not encourage, we do not want to encourage creation of health IDs from the UI. We want to focus mostly on capture and verification of health IDs and just reuse of the tools that are being provided by NDHM for the issue of health IDs. So a few things to remember when we are working with health IDs. First of all, health ID number is present on all health IDs issued. The user chosen health ID is only present on self-registered health ID. So for example, if you're creating a health ID with Aadhaar, you will not get a user chosen alias. Instead, it will simply have the 14 digit number that was created as part of, issued as part of the creation of the health ID. The no health IDs must be created by force or from a without the explicit consent and full knowledge of the user. This is very important. There is a consent that is absolutely required to be collected as part of any health ID creation. And you cannot force anybody to get a health ID. It is completely voluntary. There is absolutely no obligation that users must create one or share one with the health facility. So the only reason why someone should create a health ID is if they want access to their health records digitally. If for any reason they do not wish to get access to their records, or for other reasons they do not want the health ID to issue a records. And in health, there are many, many ethical edge cases, and this is extremely important that we adhere to these policies that have been set up by NDHM on this particular use case. Also remember that your health IDs are by design not necessarily unique. Users can have more than health ID, and they decide which ID they want to share with the health facility. And while the process is designed to reduce an accidental creation of duplicate IDs, it is not going to stop people from having more than one health ID. So that's the background and section on health ID. So we have we're going to take a few queries for this section specific to the health ID. So request people who want to raise hands. We'll start with Arul Kumar T.
Arul? Hi, can you hear me?
Yes.
Great. Talking about Health Locker, right? So it could be a third party who could provide the infrastructure. And is it also something which National Health Mission would have their own locker as such? And are there any, you know, like pricing or something which we could collect from the, you know, like users who are actually using it?
Yeah. So at this point, there has been no decision done on whether NDHM will actually offer a locker service. It's still under discussion within the National Health Authority. At this point, we are building a reference application for showing how a locker would work. Any commercial structure between HRPs and facilities, between lockers and users, in our opinion, would be completely market driven. And it is not something where the National Health Authority or NDHM is likely to take a position as to what should be the commercial structure.
Understood. Yeah. Thank you.
Gulshan? Gulshan?
Yeah. So basically, I have a question regarding for a user, if he is going with one application where he is storing all the records, right? So is it specific that he can only use that app for record storing, or he can use multiple apps for storing his records?
Yeah, so I think we don't view, when if you think of an app and its storage of records, always remember that a mobile app is storing the health records on the local storage of the device. And so the idea of a locker is to provide a cloud alternative to just the local storage. It is quite possible that I could have 5 mobile apps on my phone and each of them implement a HIU, and I could be able to see health records on all of my various apps. So, you know, there can be multiple HIUs. There is nothing stopping that.
Okay. Yeah. Thank you.
Yeah. Karthik?
Hi. My first question, I had a question. It was related to the issuance of, let's say, patient's health ID. You mentioned that a patient can probably have multiple IDs issued accidentally or deliberately in whatever sense. But once that happens, how are we going to manage the content manager, which is basically
identifying where that patient's data is stored. So if a patient has multiple such health IDs, all this data is going to come from different. So there's no actual like EHR being created or a PHR being created for the patient there with multiple health IDs. The second question was when we spoke about.
Go ahead, Karan. Finish your question.
The second question that I wanted to ask about you, you mentioned something about integrating a biometric, which is probably linked with eKYC in the Aadhaar database. But for doing that, we need to first register ourselves as an AUA and then a KUA license is issued. And there was a jurisdiction by Supreme Court very recently which prohibited private companies from doing that. So there would be a cost involved in doing that. Would the NDHM be bearing that cost or it will come on to the providers?
Yeah, so both are kind of good questions. On the thanks. So Karthik, I'll take the second one first and maybe I'll ask you to repeat the first question for me. On the second one, NDHM is the global AUA. And we have recently had the government pass all the requisite policies and laws required for use of Aadhaar for managing and creating of these health IDs. So health facilities, which under our policies would be allowed to create health IDs, will not require anything apart from Aadhaar certified, what's called as an RD device, a registered device, biometric device from Aadhaar, which is available for as low as, you know, 1,500 to 2,000 rupees today. And they will be able to, at no cost to the user or to themselves, be able to create Aadhaar-linked health IDs for their patients. So all the legal requirements are taken care of by NDHM and there is absolutely no cost on doing it. NDHM plays the role of both AUA, ASA, and whatever else is under the hood required from an Aadhaar perspective. That's the first part. Could you repeat your question on the first question again?
Yes. So the first part was, so you mentioned that the patient voluntarily or...
IDs. I remembered now. Thanks. Yeah. So see, the idea of multiple IDs, please remember that if, let us say, I had two health IDs and I decide that when I go to NIMHANS for my mental health care, I give one ID, and when I go to all other places, I give my other ID. It's actually my choice, and that's by design. That said, what NDHM will allow is for me to be able to move records across both my IDs into one ID if I want, and delete another ID so that I can actually create a single longitudinal record. So it's up to users, and users will have the control to be able to integrate or merge records or move records across IDs. So it's, think of it like, you know, you have two accounts and then you're actually moving contents across those two accounts, and you decide when you want to give up one account or not give up an account. So that's a similar kind of thinking that will happen as far as multiple IDs is concerned under NDHM. Can we go to Ananda Sengupta?
Yeah, hi. I just want to just quick summarize so that I can completely be sure. So we this data gets entered, like the list of potential data that you talked about. We enter in our system, then we make a system call, and then you send back a health ID, right? Is that the final? Just want to confirm that.
So we will come to how do you collect. If you're asking about creation of health IDs, or are you asking about...
Yes, creation of the health ID. The first time the first patient comes and registers.
Yeah. See, creation of the health ID, you use the healthid.ndhm.gov.in. So let's say you're a health facility. You can set up a desk and you will get a login and a password for... If you're a registered facility, you will get a login and a password for healthid.gov.in. NDHM.gov.in. You can just log in there, and then it has a UI with which you can create the health ID for any patient who's coming and issue them a health ID. So the tools to issue a health ID are already available. Of course, you can also just tell users that they can get the health ID themselves. So anybody can get a health ID by visiting healthid.gov.in or downloading a compatible mobile app, and from the mobile app they can create it. mobile apps which implement this facility will have to use the Health ID APIs to do that job.
Of course. Okay, so we don't have the responsibility of that. That anyway, they will enter into that particular site or details of that, and that's it. So that way, the responsibility or the legal part of it, we don't have to worry about.
Yes, that's right. Thanks.
Okay. All right, thanks.
Ronak?
Yes, so I think you mentioned about the point of front-end UI not generating health PHR IDs. So I had a question in that regard with regards to, say, for example, I'm going to a clinic which is using an EMR platform. So now once I as a patient, I'm going to that clinic, I'm registering with my basic details. So as a EMR platform service provider, will I be able to create health IDs for that patient which is going to a particular clinic where the EMR solution is being used? And second is essentially, will the specific clinic in that case be counted as a facility, or it will not be counted as a facility in the facility registry?
No. So clinics are facility registries, and clinics, like I said just before, will have access to a UI in which they can create a health facility ID. So there is no coding required on your side. Sure. If you do believe there is an absolute value in creating a health ID through your own software, you know, you can do that using the health ID APIs. But please remember that the rules are that it must be done with explicit consent of the user, and it is not something that is done using the registration information that you are collecting in the backend.
Perfect, sounds good.
Rahul?
Yes. So in case of an assisted registration for health ID, so let's imagine a PHC where a rural patient is coming in, what is the recommended step for a paramedic if the patient says, I forgot my health ID, or I have a health ID but I do not remember? Should the paramedic register his health ID again, or what's the...
Yeah, so there are tools available for recovery as well as finding your lost health ID. All of them are available on healthid.ndhm.gov.in. Some of them are already live, some of them are in development. But every facility will get access to using healthid.ndhm.gov.in and can just use that to help the user either isolate or find his health ID or not. You will also find out that we do have a way by which even if you don't collect a health ID, it can be linked later using a discover and link process. So you will see that as you learn more about the documentation. So it's absolutely fine to register a patient using their name, year of birth, gender, and capturing a mobile, and you will still be able to help them get their digital records later on if they so wish to. Manish?
Kiran, my question was, for EMR software, if a doctor is registered or onboarded, then is it responsibility of EMR software? I mean, can EMR software facilitate the creation of facility ID for that doctor through APIs? And if yes, then is there any consent, etc., which needs to be maintained at EMR software level? Or we can just call the API and create the facility ID for that doctor?
So I think, Manish, we have not yet released the APIs for DigiDoctor or for Facility Registry. So once those are released in early October, any software will be able to help a doctor enroll in DigiDoctor or enroll in Facility Registry. And also those same APIs will help, a doctor to validate or authenticate themselves, as well as to digitally sign prescriptions and so on. So we'll have a separate webinar on that once those APIs are published. But sure, at this point, those are not available. And anybody registering for a facility or anybody registering on DigiDoctor must go through the UIs that have been provided by NDHM at doctor.ndhm.gov.in and facility.ndhm.gov.in.
Okay.
Vidya?
And once they create those IDs, then they can apply that in the EMR.
Yes.
Okay.
That's correct.
Great. Thank you. Thanks, Kiran.
Vidya?
Yeah, Kiran. So my question is, Kiran, see, this entire ecosystem is right now made to be voluntary, correct? So it depends. Any player can opt in to this ecosystem basis, you know, choice. If that's the case, why are we allowing creation of multiple user IDs and providing people, you know, the freedom to create multiple IDs if they so wish? Because anyway, they are opting in by choice, right?
Yeah, so see, uniqueness or making sure, yeah, so making sure that, you know, let's say one individual has just one ID does, you know, require a mandatory linking to Aadhaar, which is not something that legally or otherwise is actually going to be tenable.
Because, Kiran, if I may interrupt you for a second, now in case of, let's say, an illiterate person for whom you're assisting or providing assistance in creating a health ID, you're saying you'll take either biometric or Aadhaar. So that does provide a certain bit of uniqueness for that category. But for self-registered people, you're saying that either mobile phone or Aadhaar can be provided. And I guess that kind of leaves a little bit of room for creation of multiple IDs, right? So is there a pattern that we're seeing here in terms of treatment between you know, somebody who's opting for self-registration versus who's been assisted in creating his health ID?
Yeah, so even somebody being assisted to create a health ID can have multiple IDs if they want to choose to.
Okay,
it's not that we are saying, so the design is, by design we are saying that you can have multiple IDs. There are many, it's a long debate, not something for this webinar.
Okay.
But healthcare has many very difficult ethical boundaries and conditions, and we have made conscious calls to err on the side of the user on whether they want to have digital records, not want to have digital records. And I can give you things like abortion data, you know, sexual health preferences data, and there are mental health data. All of these are difficult things. And we want to make sure that users are completely in control of whether they want to have them digitally, not want to have them digitally, keep them separate, and so on. And so that's the direction that we have gone. Okay. Sethuraman?
I had just one more question.
Sethuraman?
Yeah. Can you hear me?
Yes.
So my question is, you know, again, in the same area as multiple IDs for the same person. So is it technically possible for somebody to create two health IDs which are linked to the same Aadhaar number?
Yes, it will be possible for you to have multiple IDs and still link them to the same Aadhaar number, yes.
Okay. And what about, is there any restriction if somebody is opting for government schemes like say PMJ or something like that? Is there any restrictions that these people will have to have only one ID or anything of that sort?
Not one ID, but they will have to have an Aadhaar linked ID. So essentially, if you are using your health ID in the context, if you're using health IDs in the context of what is called as a notified scheme under Section 7 of the Aadhaar Act, then the government has the right to demand that your health ID be linked to Aadhaar before services are provided. Sameer?
Yep. So if there are two IDs, then they could use, they have the freedom to use either one of them in any of those schemes.
Yeah, but then they would both have to be linked to Aadhaar, so that we know that, you know, there is no double dipping on benefits from government.
Yeah.
Aman? Sorry.
I have two questions, Kiran. One is like regarding the health ID, I think you already answered that we can create it, but it is like a process which we need to follow while creating the health ID from the own app, let's say. And second is, let's say if I have like two health IDs and I am providing the Aadhaar ID at both of the health facility, so will that two health IDs will be allowed, right?
Yes, that's what I said. Okay. And you can choose what you give at a health facility. Aman?
My question is regarding the mediation. Whenever there is mediation happening, when creation of health ID is happening, so this mediation is supposed to happen on the platform consuming the API, or it's going to happen on the NDHM portal, the healthidnhm.org.
I mean, we are flexible in the sense that there are APIs available for you to create a health ID. Like, for example, if you were implementing a mobile app and you wanted to create health IDs for users, then you know you can use the Health ID APIs, but we don't think it is necessary for most EMR or LMIS players to do that. JS, I hope I answered your question. JS?
Yes, Kiran, I have two questions. The first is there appears to be an overlap between the functions of HRP and HIP. And I wish to go back to a question that was asked earlier about a locker, and and you had responded that the NHA is still looking into it. Now, going across to another industry which seems to have done this substantially, the financial sector, could we expect something like the DMAT players in the financial sector industry coming up in this industry as an NHA-approved segment as a locker service? That's my first question.
Yeah, sure. So I
the
think
second question. Yeah.
Go ahead, Jess.
So the second question relates to that, and it goes even further back to another question that was asked about PHCs. PHCs are obviously state government entities, and they would not wish to have a private player being reposited with some kind of a monopoly. So this seems to suggest that the government would, in fact, preferred towards some kind of entity which could be a government-owned locker service or otherwise. So I just want you to clarify on those two questions.
Yeah, no, I think you're confusing the role of the locker, in my opinion. So okay. Let's just understand that, health repository providers hold health data as and when it's created by any facility. So typically these are software. So even whether you take a PHC needs some piece of software. Of course, it's the government's prerogative as to how it sources that software. The expectation from NDHM is that any software that the government is sourcing for any public facility be NDHM compliant, so that any health treatment provided at any public facility is also digitally shared with patients, similar to how we expect the private ecosystem also to be sharing records digitally with patients. HRPs hold records. In many ways, the role of a HRP is to ensure that a facility can essentially meet its obligations that I showed of being a HIP. So, the obligations, in some sense, HRPs are people who are assisting facilities to essentially play the role of a HIP. A health locker is always on the side of the user. It is not on the side of the facility. So Each individual chooses which health locker they want. So think of it as, me, Kiran, decides that I want to keep my health records. I want to have a safety of keeping my health records and a copy of it for myself in the cloud for long term. So I choose a locker service and I say, okay, my records will stay with this locker. So locker is also an open specifications, and we expect users to be able to choose from a variety of locker providers who will be available in the market. It is not yet clear as to who will participate in this. It is left to be completely open. We have no restrictions on who wants to actually participate in providing any of these services, except that they must have a legal entity and a presence in India at this point. Vaibhav?
Okay.
Yeah, hi. So I have two questions basically. One thing Raunak had clarified earlier, I think, in one of the question about EMR providers, wherein the health ID will be created by the clinics as a facility who are using our EMR solutions. So in this case, can we then maintain that health ID into our EMR vault, wherein we are keeping all the health records for the doctors and patients, right? And second thing is, can we also have an integration to fetch the health records for patients based on that health ID for the next visits when the doctor is trying to connect to the EMR solutions?
Yeah, I think you might have missed some portion of this one. Yes, the answer to yes is both is yes. All HRPs and HIPs are allowed to store health IDs. In fact, that's the expectation, that you will collect and store health IDs and that you will link them with any health record that you create for that patient. you are also allowed to get the patient's medical history from other places that the patient may have visited, but you will have to do that using consent. So in later sessions, you will actually understand, and through the demo, you will understand how that process works. So we'll move forward. Harsha?
Yeah, Kiran. I mean, I had a couple of questions, but as you know, some of them were answered. So one question that I have specifically is on the consent, since it is the only requirement before you create or you know you move anything. So the consent form and the consent process, right? Is there any mandate that you have set as to what needs to be the process, and also yes. What are the specifics that needs to go into the consent form as such?
Time to read documentation. Okay. Consent artifact is a very well-defined object. It's based on the MITIE consent specification. We'll get to it in later sessions. So if you don't mind, if anybody else has a question on health ID, I'll take it. Otherwise, I would like to move to the next section. We're going to run out of time otherwise. Rohit, Subhash,
For multiple health IDs, there's an application, means my application, and I want to restrict the user. Means not means if the user is creating their health ID from my application, and I want to restrict to create only one health ID from my application. If he has created from other application, that's fine. Is that fine, or also I have to provide them to create multiple health IDs?
Yeah, by the policies that we do, you have to allow them to create multiple health IDs if they so wish to. The APIs that we provide you methods to know if there is another health ID, present it to the user and say, do you still want to create another health ID? But if they wish to, then you still need to allow that. So I'm just going to go back to the presentation section. Yeah, Subhash.
I have one question. Yes. The question, is there any sandbox to create an API using, sandbox to create a health ID for the testing purpose? I know that there is an API, but is there any UI to check that?
Yeah, there is. The URL is going to change, but you can today do it through HealthID beta, H-E-A-L-T-H, HealthID beta at ndhm.gov.in. You can create a sandbox HealthID. It is going to move to a new URL, which is healthidsbx.ndhm.gov.in in a couple of days. So if you don't find it on that site, you please check the Health ID SBX site, and you will be able to create a health ID. You can also create it through the PHR mobile application that's available for download on the sandbox site.
Can you please repeat the URL again? We need to write
that. Subhash, we'll do it at the very end of the session, and I'll put up the information for everybody's access. Yeah.
Okay. Thank you.
Can I ask one last question related to this?
Yeah, please.
Is there any format in which a patient can basically withdraw the consent given at any point of time?
Yes, consents are completely revocable. We'll come to that when we deal with consents. We are not dealing with consents right now, but consents can be granted, consents can be revoked. And one of the key things, if you are implementing a health information user, is that you must adhere to the consent rules. So when a consent is withdrawn, you must destroy the records that you may have for that user.
Okay, great.
Yeah, so the second and the last section for today deals with how do you capture and verify health IDs. So we talked about the fact that facilities have to issue health IDs, and now we're going to talk about a person coming in, a patient walking in into a health facility, and then he says, look, I have a health ID and I would like you to issue me digital records with that health ID. So we will talk about one, how to capture and verify using the QR codes that are part of the Health ID ecosystem. So QR codes in Health IDs are either found on the printed card that is issued from an assisted mode, or it can also be seen within the mobile applications that support PHR. So if I have a PHR application, one of the things that we would like PHR applications to do is to show the Health ID QR code. So facilities can get themselves a 2D QR code scanner. And if you scan the QR code, you pretty much get the name, the gender, the year of birth, the address, state, district, and the mobile. So you just scan the code, and then you do something called a demographic verification. So you send all of the information that you have captured to the consent manager and the gateway, and the consent manager and the gateway gives you back something called, you know, it validates that this is indeed a valid health ID, and two, it gives you back something called an auth code, which you need to save within your ecosystem for future linking of health records. So this is option one, where you just scan from the QR code. We expect this to become fairly dominant because it makes it very easy and very fast from a health facility to do the registration. So there is no more typing, there is no more incorrect data probably being captured at the point of registration. And if this becomes a habit, it actually will be beneficial to the overall ecosystem. The second model is a reverse kind of a model, which is on the health facility, you can have something called a health facility QR code. And using your mobile app, you can scan the code. And if you scan the code, essentially the data gets posted to the endpoint URL that you have registered. And you can then do a pop-up on the appropriate desk. And the desk can then select the appropriate health ID from all the pop-ups from that pop-up window that they have. And again, you need to call the demographic verification API on the gateway and then save the auth code that you get back for linking. We are describing this a little more in detail using the sequence flow diagram that you see here. So the HIP or the HRP essentially here will essentially first call the API called /user/auth/fetch modes. So you have scanned a QR code, you have got the health ID number and all of the information, but you will send primarily the health ID number and you will say my purpose is KYC and link. And when you do that, you will get back something called what are the authentication modes that are possible for this particular health ID. So it will tell you that supported modes for authentication for this health ID include mobile OTP or Aadhaar OTP or demographics. And then you will say, okay, I want to do a verification using demographic auth. So you will do an auth init with the appropriate demographics. And then you will also do an auth confirm where you will actually send the demographic data that you have collected. And in return, you will get back an access token. And this access token is something that you have to save. And I'll stop here. And we will talk about when do you use the access token to actually link health data in a slightly later context. So these APIs are the ones. This is again available in the documentation. The links are coming up in a bit. So that's one way where we capture health data, verify it using demographics, and actually get a auth linking token in our EMR or LMIS system. The second way we do it is using something called capture and verify from a, say a patient verbally sharing their health ID or health ID number. So I could walk into a facility and say, I know I'm not carrying my PHR card or whatever. So I say that my ID is KiranMA@NDHM, and you essentially figure out what are the auth modes that are possible for validation. So there will be many authentication methods possible in the future. Right now we support mobile OTP, Aadhaar OTP, Aadhaar biometric. And in the future, you're likely to have mobile IVR and mobile app notifications as methods. And you need to do an authentication with one of the methods. So for example, if it is mobile OTP, you will trigger an authentication saying, I would like to do a mobile OTP, and OTP is going to land up on my mobile. I give you back the OTP number, and on successful authentication, you will get the details of the health ID and the linking token. And you can also populate the demographics in the registration screen and save the link for future use. So this is the same flow, but for a mobile OTP scenario. So you collect a health ID and then you say fetch auth modes. It tells you these are the auth modes possible for this particular health ID. And then you say, okay, I want to initiate authentication using auth mode equal to mobile OTP. The user gets an OTP, you collect the OTP, and then you do an auth confirm where you pass the OTP, and then the system will send back you the demographic detail that you see on the right side. So the access token that you see is the linking token that you need to save, and then it gives you all of the patient details, including the ID, the name, the gender, the year of birth, the address, and any other identifiers that the user may have. So this is how you actually collect and verify a health ID in your software. So there is documentations available for this in the sandbox. We request you to look at and understand the key concepts. How do you actually start building a health information provider, as well as the APIs for the NDHM, HIP in the documentation set. Now, what is important is that if for any reason authentication fails or the health ID demographic validation fails, it must not be stored in your records, must be discarded, because it's unlikely that it's either an, you know, an incorrect ID or a fake ID. So that's not to be there. And remember that there is, the whole process is voluntary. Registration or healthcare must not be stopped if people are not able to provide a health ID. Our recommendation, if people are not able to provide a health ID, is to do what you already do today, which is to continue to capture a name, ideally a date of birth, gender, and if possible, the mobile of the user. If you are getting an age, we request you to actually store it under the hood as year of birth and see if you can confirm that with the patient. And if you are getting a mobile number, we prefer that you can validate that so that you have a valid mobile number. We have a process called the discover and link method, which allows patients to actually discover or collect their health records even if they do not provide the health ID at the time of registration. So if a patient doesn't provide a health ID at the time of registration, they can still retrieve their records digitally if you have correctly captured the name, date of birth, gender, and a valid mobile as part of the registration. That's the link and that's the process for collection of health ID. We'll take any queries that you may have for this section.
So one question is, does the NDHM provide health IDs basis apps? Means how do user know which health ID has how many data, means what are the data, their health data accesses, means which health ID has which access? How do a user know?
You're talking about authentication methods, Rohit?
No. Actually, I was talking about, if a user comes to my application, he provides me his health ID and he asked me to fetch the digital health data. Now, how to NDHM help in accessing the data with the health IDs? Means,
yeah.
There must be some specific data to a specific health ID.
Yeah, thanks, Rohit. So we will cover that in later sections, Rohit. You are talking about how do you get consented access to health data given
yes,
a health
yes.
ID. Yeah, so we will cover that. We are right yes, now yes. just talking about how does EMR or LMIS software collect and store a valid health ID as part of their records during registration of a patient. So we'll keep the question to that. Sethuraman?
Sure. I was curious to understand how it is being envisaged as far as the offline situations, network disruptions, and scenarios such as that. Is there some thought around that?
Yeah. So there is no. So let's say you're scanning a QR code, and let's say you're completely offline. There is nothing that says that you must verify and validate and get the linking token immediately. You can do it at a later point in time, and that's one of the reasons why it is designed like that. So there is nothing. So if you have collected a valid health ID and the demographics for it, you can link patient's record for it later. Also, if you remember, I said even if you don't have a health ID but you have collected the name, age, gender, mobile, you will still be able to issue records digitally when you become online. So it is designed keeping the fact that there may be connectivity challenges in mind. Neil Kamal?
Yeah, yes. Well, one part already you have answered. And the second part is actually there is a search that ID API is there. So it starts using mobile number, gender, name, year of birth. So actually, since a person now with respect to one mobile number, gender, and name, you can have multiple health IDs. Okay.
So Nirgaman, those are basically methods to recover a health ID for people who say that they have not forgot or they don't know their health ID. They are not to be used at the point of registration. At the point of registration, either a person explicitly provides a health ID or does not provide a health ID.
Okay, but it returns only a single value. Whether it will return the list, the methods return is not an array, it returns a single value.
The recovery process is designed to help you determine your health ID, say just given starting with a mobile number and some additional information. So recovery of a health ID is a completely separate problem from collection and verification of a health ID. Yeah, thanks. Akhilesh Singh.
So my question is around the decision of using health ID for, you know, collecting and verifying, because in my past experience, people who are traveling from remote villages, right, they will not remember their health ID or they will not remember, you know, their Aadhaar. And since you always, I think you said that mobile number will be used while creating these health IDs, why can't we just use the mobile number for fetching, you know, the health ID of the person?
Yeah, so remember that a mobile ID, mobile number can be used across a family. So a single mobile number can hold 3, 4, 5 health IDs if the family so desires. So it's usually a shared device in many parts of India. So you can actually use that to kind of recover a health ID and, you know, build a process around that. But by design, we have not, we have gone down this path of saying that, you know, you can also recover a health ID using people's Aadhaar, and that's
So the only concern there is, you know, it will be very tough for people to remember their health IDs.
We will have to see how this plays out. You know, we understand these concerns, but some of these are calls of balance on what is probably better from a consumer perspective versus users, in terms of users' protection and safety, and whether they are consciously saying this is what I want versus the system trying to say, okay, this is what you want. So those things are important. Shushant Jain.
I have two questions. One is regarding that ki every time the patient visits the hospital where the health repository systems are being used, so every time they have to go through the entire activity.
What is entire?
Like they'll be scanning the QR code, maybe if they are having those QR codes and giving the consent again to link up with the patient.
Usually what happens in most EMR and LMIS systems is that each visit of a patient to a hospital is always registered as a separate visit. So this process that we just described can be used as part of every visit. We will come a little later into, you know, let's say in a single visit, if it's an inpatient visit, it's probably the patient is staying for about 3 days. You're probably going to create a lot of different type of health records in the 3 days. We have a construct that we will cover in the next session called a care context. So you can have a single care context for a single visit. So if, for example, there's an OPD visit, you would have a separate care context for each visit or each encounter with the patient. You would typically have a separate registration and a linking token that you would collect. Mahesh?
Another question I've got, sorry to interrupt.
Go ahead, Shushan.
Whenever the patient is revoking the consent, as we discussing earlier, being an HIU, you have to ensure that all the records are being removed. In that case also, we need to dealing the health ID with the patient record as well, in that case, or it's only about the patient record?
That's only on the HIU side. So see, whenever a hospital creates a health record, there are medico-legal reasons also why the hospital needs to retain the records for its own purposes. So the HIP and the HRP side do not have very different legal requirements compared to the HIU side. So if the hospital created a record for a patient, the rules it follows for keeping those records are driven by the HIP, HRP guidelines as well as the medico-legal guidelines of the country. Only the HIU, so that is records you fetch of the user across all providers that they have gone to, need to meet the consent requirements.
Okay.
Shushant?
Mahesh here. So the access token that the facility gets after the verification from concept manager, what is the life of it? When does it expire?
Yeah, so the linking token does have an expiry. I don't know what is that, Sukrit or Anshuman?
So Kiran, as of now, we have kept it configurable after the first linking.
Yeah, so basically, Mahesh, to understand that, the life of the token is till you link a health record or a care context to that token for that visit.
Okay. So it's again, the same process has to be repeated again.
Yes, if you are going to link a different care context, yes.
I see, okay, thank you.
Yeah, Saida Dhanavan, Saida?
Hi, Kiran. So we have over 3 million users and most of them are villagers.
Okay.
We operate mostly in rural India. Now, the major problem with them is they don't really understand health IDs or multiple health IDs.
Yeah.
At the same time, currently we have family level segregation of the internal segregation based on the phone number. Phone number is the only unique identity for us. Now, when it comes to users, for these users, it becomes simple if providers like us can also create the health IDs. But in the beginning, you mentioned that the HIPs need not to be the health ID generators. Is that right?
No, no. We want HIPs to be health ID generators, not to be. To be.
Okay. Okay. So we should be able to use the health ID. Should be able to generate the health IDs and.
Yeah.
Associate those users at the primary HIPs with us.
What I was saying is that, you can use the existing tools provided by NDHM to create the health IDs rather than try to build the whole thing in your own software. That's all.
We'll just be calling the APIs and mostly if the SDK part is available, we'll directly picking up the SDK and integrating it if there is a possibility.
Yes, yes, it exists. The APIs are available on the sandbox. Please go look at the APIs under the section called health ID. And you will see all the APIs required to create a health ID.
Have already gone through, and I think developer had already covered that.
We'll move forward. Thanks, Juhi Bhaskar.
Yeah, hi. So my question is regarding the health ID link feature. Now, if we were to offer it as part of our application, are there any legal or design guidelines on what can be communicated to the patient if we want to encourage them to do so?
Your query is not clear, Ma. Could you repeat that for me? I didn't understand. What do you mean by the link? Which link are we talking about? You're talking about linking of health records?
Yeah, so what I mean is if we were to offer to a patient that, you can generate a health ID to link all your records and have it in one place, what can or cannot be communicated to the patient as part of this offering? Are there any guidelines regarding that?
There may be. I am not fully aware yet. That would be part of the NDHM IEC related stuff. So I will not be able to answer this. But yes, you should check once our other guidelines. But if there is something, we'll publish it in terms of what can be communicated.
One follow-up question. So all the consent application and OTP should be going through the OTP service. That would be implemented, that is implemented towards NDHM, not from our side, right?
I am not clear about the question.
Means, so whenever there is a consent notification is going or the OTP, so that would be implemented to NDHM, not from our side, not from our application.
Okay, so in this case, yes, the OTP would be sent by NDHM.
And all the consent notifications also.
Yes, you'll learn about the consent manager, Karthik.
Yeah, hi. So I just wanted to play out a scenario because we are saying that the software providers are expected to maintain the data that is captured at a facility. how does that PHR look like when one health ID transfers from hospital one, which is using one provider, and hospital two, which is using another? How does that PHR play out to be?
There is a demo at the next thing right after this queries is a demo, and I think you will get the answer to that, Karthik.
Okay, great.
Ronak?
So my question was around, I think in one of the iSpirit presentations, we heard about linking of different health IDs. So for example, I think it was already asked in terms of if say there is a one mobile number in the family, will the head of the family be able to associate PHR IDs for all family members?
Yeah, see, a single, there are two different concepts. A single mobile number can be, you know, when we create a health ID using a mobile, we are actually using a combination of the name, year of birth, gender, and the verified mobile number to be unique. So a single mobile number can be used to create multiple health IDs across a family. There is a separate concept which is about giving consent for nominees. So for example, with children or with elderly parents, you know, you can actually provide the consent on behalf of the child. In fact, you are legally required to do so in India till the child turns 18, or for elderly parents who may not be capable of providing their own consent. So health IDs have a concept of nominees, and you can actually set up nominees, and that's still not implemented. It's still under implementation, but that's coming, and that's how, you know, multiple people will actually be able to consent on your behalf when required.
Okay. Yeah.
Ron.
The fields that you mentioned are name, DOB, gender, and phone number, right? For generation of a unique.
That's correct. It's there in the health ID documentation. So please take a look at that. Yeah. Marshall.
Yeah. Hi, Kiran. I'm Marshall here. So once a user is given a consent, will a HAU get access to all of the medical records of the user, or is there a mechanism to issue consent to view only a specific medical record, because the user will be able to get complete control?
You will see that again in the demo. The consent object defines what you get access to. So again, the demo will be clearer on the consent in a few minutes. Yeah, Tanish?
Okay.
Hi, my question is around the consent. So once the consent is given by the patient, is it valid for some time period? Since I read it in the document,
Yes. Since
it is valid for some time period. So what is the
answer? Tanish, it will be answered in the demo in a few minutes. Again, we are jumping the gun on consent. Consent has a time period and an expiry that the user can control. Yeah.
Fair enough. Thank you.
Yeah, Hardik Mistry.
Yes, sir. I have one question about that. If I have a one number and I have created one health ID, after that my number is disconnected. Means I doesn't have a recharge, and another person can use it. Then how can we authorize that by OTP, by mobile?
Yeah. So there are mechanisms being devised right now for you to be able to also change the associated mobile number with your health ID. Those processes are coming, and we will want the ability for you to actually, you know, continue with your health ID. So you should remember that if you go today to healthidbeta.gov.in and ndhm.gov.in and create your health ID, you will notice that we not only have an authentication with mobile OTP, you can also link your Aadhaar, you can also set a password. So there are multiple methods by which you will be able to recover your health ID and keep its continuity going. So those are all being designed. Anuj?
Yeah, hi. Can you hear me?
Yes.
Okay. So see, we are a application where people give their medical background history, and that is used for issuance of insurance, health insurance to them. And so this information is a valid information, and that impacts how these people are able to get insurance or a claim in that. Now, do we need to register as a health insurance provider, HIP? And if yes, when I go to the facility.ndhm website, all those facilities are physical facilities which are mentioned there.
Yeah, you are a HIU, right? You're not a HIP. You are a user of health information. Are you a creator of health information?
We are a creator of health information, yes. and there is no medical record linked to that information. Customer says, I have a history of headache, I have a history of blah, 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 something's happened. But there's no, customer is not having any medical record for that. But then insurance considers that to allow or not allow insurance to this guy.
So I would like to know or understand this use case more. So you can write to me separately. So, you know, my ID is, right now it's Kiran, K-I-R-A-N at nha.gov.in. So please write to that email ID and then we'll take a look at the use case. Thank you.
Kiran, Kiran at nha.gov.in.
Yes.
Thank you.
Anuj? Anuj Jindal? Yeah, thanks. Avinash?
Hi, Karan. Are you able to hear me?
Yeah.
Okay. I'm not sure if I'm jumping the gun here, but in terms of care context, who determines the length of the care context? Would it be the HIP or?
Yeah, the HIP or the HRP determines the length of the care context. The guideline is to say that, you know, typically one encounter, so maybe one inpatient encounter or one OPD encounter should be part of one care context.
Alright.
We'll learn about that more in the next session.
Got it.
Can any of the other questions are related to collection and verification of health ID? So we'll take that, otherwise we should go to the demo. We are running out of time.
Can you hear me?
Yeah.
Yeah, so I had a question about like whenever the user, like a family is registered to a particular mobile number and we want to collect the authentication token and health ID for one of them. So whenever we are authenticating using the mobile OTP, so what would be the like result of that particular authentication API?
Yeah.
Will we be getting the list of all the user and from which we can select the particular user or, how would that pan out?
No, you should look at the API. No, you will not get the list of multiple users. Unless the user can actually provide at least some minimal information for the search, we do not return. We can, given a mobile number, we tell you that there are multiple IDs involved, but if you want to get a specific health ID, you must provide at least a name, a partial name, year of birth, and or gender to actually get the health ID back. Yeah, Prashant?
Okay, thanks.
Actually, I wanted to ask you, you just told me that every time the we want to create an visit, we have that health ID. So can we store that health ID in our database?
Yes, you can. As long as you are a HIP or HRP, there is nothing, no, you can store the health ID in your database or even a HIU. Any one of the entities in the ecosystem, they are all allowed to store health ID.
Okay.
Yes, Kiran. I have a question about issuance or validation of a health ID in low connectivity environments where a data connection cannot be established.
Yeah. So we talked about this in the beginning. So the APIs are designed actually so that you can actually collect and then verify later whenever you want. So the whole offline methodology is actually part of the design. So if you're scanning a health ID QR code, you can save that information. There is nothing which says that you must fire the API for verification at the time you collect. You can do it later, but you must fire it before you link any health record.
Thanks.
Avinash? Okay. So, Sukrit?
Yeah.
So, can we go to the demo?
Yes, Kiran. So I'll first show from where you can get the APK and then I'll actually show the APK on my phone. Is my screen visible?
Yes.
So on the Sandbox website, inside, if you see, there's this FAQ section. Over there, there is the what is the patient tab. So you can download the APK from here. If it's a clickable link, once you click on it, the APK will be downloaded. And as and when we update the app, we will release the newer version, the newer sandbox version here itself.
Sukrit, it's also available from home page. Go to home.
It's also available from other places.
Yeah, just go down. Yeah, just go down and then you will see the PHR mobile app. Just click on that, please. Yeah, on that, you will have the PHR mobile app.
The mobile app.
And then you have the download APK here.
So now I'll just stop sharing and share from my phone. So this is the PHR app that we have built as a reference. There are some graphic screens that we have just to give an understanding of what the app is about. So once we see all the screen, it takes you to the page, the login page. Okay. Now, if you have a health ID, you can log in from here. Else, you can register. Quickly do a registration. So I'll use my own number. It should trigger an OTP. So after you verify the mobile number, the user can choose whether or not they want to use their Aadhaar. So for the demo, let's proceed without Aadhaar. Just note that in case of Aadhaar, the information here, the user doesn't have to enter. It will be automatically fetched. Just calling it demo sandbox. Middle name and all are optional. In the birth date, only year field is mandatory. These are not mandatory fields. Gender is a mandatory field. And address, as a part of address information, we capture a state and a district. So let's select, say, Andaman and us. And here is where we are asking for a consent. You click on user agreement, the link, the entire consent text is present here. Okay, so the user has to explicitly accept, agree to the consent, and then register. Now, at this point, the account creation has been initiated, but the health ID, which is something the user should choose themselves. So let's do it. Sandbox. We'll go to the next, as the health ID is available. So we'll use this password. So now you see it first, your health ID is this, and the health ID number. Since health ID number is there on the top, okay, it still says health ID, but and then the health ID is the sandbox.test@sdx. Okay, so shall I go to my account? So it asks for permission because we store detailed data in the phone itself. So now on this screen, on the bottom, you see there are three major tabs. One is records, next is providers, and the third tab is the consent tab. So basically, once record is present here, you should be able to see the data on this screen. Providers will show you the list of providers, or that is HIPs that you have linked records present in. And on the consent tab is where you can go and accept or deny consents. Okay. And on the top right, we have a profile screen. If you go there, you see the profile details as captured. And as Kiran mentioned about the QR code will be visible on this page itself, this screen. So any questions here before we move on?
So one question here, which is essentially, for the registration, having the details of what gets assigned as a consent ID or a PHR ID, so that is either triggered or this.
I couldn't hear you very clearly.
I said the choosing of the health ID is always either defined.
So there are two things. If you stick to the name, there are two things. One is a health ID number, which is a 14-digit number, which is automatically generated or system generated. The health ID, which is now sandbox.test@sbx, that is something the user chooses.
Okay.
And the @sbx determines which consent manager it is in.
Okay.
So now there is this method to link records. See, Let me click on link records. Now, if you remember, during the demo earlier, I registered a demo hospital. If I search the demo hospital, see the demo facility, it is present here. So once your facility is registered as a facility using those API calls, you can search it in this app. Okay. So now I don't have any data here. This is the newly created health ID. I'll just stop sharing. Is the screen visible?
Yes.
So this web EMR is something implemented on us.
No.
Sorry.
Please continue.
Something implement. I'll just log in here with an existing health ID. So now this is, let's assume this to be the hospital that the patient is visiting. So I'll register the patient on the hospital. And I put in a health ID. What was that? Sandbox.test. So the user information is fetched here and we need to start a visit. Let's call it outpatient and submit. So as of now, this visit is something which is being linked to a care context. Okay.
Right.
So let's, using this patient, let's capture some quick information, upload diagnostic report. Something. And I'll submit the report. Yeah. So the report has been captured here. Okay. Now let's go back to the PHR viewer. So I have logged in here. Now let's try to link the record. So this is the discovery and link flow, as Kiran mentioned earlier. Okay, as of now, the HIP, the record has not yet been linked. The HIP just captured the information. So, Web EMR EBC Hospital is the hospital there. And you see, as a part of this discovery request, we send some details like this. And also we send the health ID and the health ID number to the hospital. Click on fetch records. It says that on this day you have a visit, and I'll click on link. Can you see this?
Yes.
Now I will click on link selected records. So there's an OTP. So this is still under discussion. Do we really need an OTP here? But as of now, it works with any OTP. So now once you approve the linking, so the HIQ, or in this case, the patient app, tries to get the record from the hospital. Now, if I go to the linked providers, you see the Web EMR ABC Hospital is now present there. And if I go to my records, okay, it now successfully fetched the record, go there. And if I open this, I also have the record as it was captured there, and I have an attachment which I added. I can view it using a PDF viewer.
Right.
Right. So any questions here?
Quick question here. This is Bharat. So if this record has to be stored on a local locker, what would be the process from here on? Okay, this is just the linking of the record to the patient app, isn't it?
This is linking of the record to the patient app, and temporary, the record is current, the data is currently stored in the phone itself, right? What we are viewing here is not something you're viewing from the hospital, it's stored local. There is concept of a locker.
All right. Thank you.
One question.
Hello.
One question here.
Sukrit, I suggest that you go in the order in which hands have been raised.
I was given for some reason, I can't see the order of the hands.
So, Asta, please ask your question.
Hello. You are able to hear me, right?
Yeah, Asta. Not Saida. Asta. Okay, go ahead, Saida.
Hi, Sukrit. You mentioned that it's a link record. Is it link record or link the provider?
It linked a care context within the provider, for the provider. So basically, okay, it worked is when I go here and I search ABC hospital or whatever, that I send the information to the hospital saying fetch me records for this details, and hospital sends it something like this, like okay. So now you can, means since there is one now, if there are multiple care contexts and all, you can choose.
All right. So just let me put one scenario. Say for example, I'm the health tech provider and I have the app. My users upload the records from time to time, right? Now, should I be creating multiple care contexts over there, or should I be able to say that there is only one care context, but whenever someone needs the data from me as a HIP, then I should be creating only, floating only one care context. So over the period of 3 months.
Yeah. So the current recommendation is that for every patient encounter that a care context is created. So basically, like I said earlier, if it's an inpatient visit where it's lasting 3 days, you will have one care context. But if it's an OPD visit, you'll probably have a separate care context for that.
If I have my app provider, I'm facilitating the record storage.
App provider, that's different, and you're talking about user
uploading the records.
So that's, we'll cover that in a separate session, Saida. Yeah?
All right, great.
Jatin? Jatin?
Hi. Can you hear me?
Yes, we can.
When HIP sends data to the HIP sends the data to the HIU, so every time they send the document with in the JSON data, or only text data is provided. Means they attach the documents every time.
You mean these document, or you mean the FHIR document?
FHIR document.
So I am not clear about your question here.
When HIU requests to the data to the HIP, and HIP sends the data to the HIU. So
yes.
in the fire JSON data is sent the HIP to the HIU. So HIP sends every time document attached the document with the JSON, or maybe getting only text over there.
No. So see, there are different JSON formats. We will be covering the FHIR standards in the next session. In this particular case, in the demonstration, we uploaded attachment, and attachments will come every time because they are inline documents. There is no, it's not like you get a URL and then you have to fetch it. So it's an inline document. So yes, it will be sent every time.
Okay. Yeah. Thank you.
It will come in a form of object, I guess, right? PDF will come in a form of object.
Yeah, thank you.
Sanjay?
Yeah, hi. I have two questions. Question number one is, if it is a PDF, that is fine. But what about DICOM images that are associated with CT, MRIs, radiology?
So currently the FHIR standards for full DICOM high resolution images is pending. It's not part of, we have released standards for 5 types of information to be shared. They essentially include the diagnostic reports, discharge summaries, OPD notes, prescriptions at this point. So there are more detailed standards coming for some of the others. We are looking for feedback on which ones are important, but full imaging studies as per the FHIR standard is likely to be supported as part of the NDHM specifications in the future.
Okay, the second question is,
go ahead, Sanjay.
Yeah, so basically I am a HIU. Okay, I pass on the consent. I pass on my request that, okay, for a certain patient, I want to see the data. Now, this consent, I presume, will go to consent manager.
Yes. Yeah.
Right? And then and consent manager would send, would get the consent from the patient.
Yes.
Okay, so consent manager, sorry.
One second, Sanjay, just hold
yeah, it. Sure.
Can we just do a quick demo of that? Is that
yes,
possible?
Exactly.
Okay,
we're going to have a view of that. So we'll just show you how a consent request can be raised by a HIU and how, you know, the consent is approved by a user.
My one more question is, okay, if there are multiple context IDs, okay, who will hold all these information? Will it be the consent manager who will store that for a patient? These are all 4 or 5 context IDs with one or multiple HIPs, or how?
So Sanjay, the role of the consent manager is primarily to maintain an index of which all HRPs have my health data for every care context. So that's what it has, and it also has a list of all my consents and its statuses. Sukrit, please show a demonstration of the can you also start by saying where you are, because you know this is on how did you get to this UI?
Yes. So this is a demo HIU that we have implemented. It's accessible on the sandbox itself.
It's there on the first page. Sukrit, if you go to home, it's the 4th tab. Yeah.
So this is the demo HIU that we have implemented and available on the sandbox. So here, if you go, you can click on new. This has login credentials. I was already logged in. So if you click on new consent request, this is what a basic consent form looks like. Okay, the first step we need to do here is validate the health. I'll try to use the
Using sandbox.test.
Click that and click on search. So it found the patient. Then you have to define the purpose of the request. So let's call it care management. The health info from and to dates, basically from which year or which time do you want the consent or want the health data from, and then is from to which date you want the health data. So let's keep it today. Then the types of health information that you want access to, or the HIU wants access to. So it's OP consultation, discharge summary, prescription, and diagnostic report. So these are the 4 that we are supporting right now here. And then comes a consent expiry. So basically, for how long do you want the data? Okay, does that make sense?
Whether if let's say patient provides the access, end user provides the access, that okay, as an app user, I can have this all the records stored in one particular app. Is that possible without an expiry?
I didn't get that question. Sorry.
My question is, like, let's say from end user point of view, from the patient point of view, if let's say if I get a consent from a patient that okay, from all the service providers, I will get these reports and I will store it in one particular app. This is possible, right, via consent?
So you can share the data with one particular HIU, okay. But what you
you are talking about is more in terms of a locker that Kiran was talking.
Yes.
So that construct of the locker, like, it's still in the designing phase. We have.
We'll be publishing the specifications for a locker by first week of October. So go ahead, Sukrit, please send the consent request.
Create the consent request. Okay, now I will stop it. Go to the app again. So we have the linked providers and we have consents here. One refreshing, this came up. See, admin from Tata Memorial Hospital. It's Tata Memorial Hospital because that is the name of that HIU I showed. Okay. And it shows the summary, purpose of the request. And once you click on it, you get more information. It says the information request from and to date, the type of health information it is requesting access for, and when does it expire. Now, as a user, before
you can edit, just show the edit capability.
As a user, before choosing to grant or deny, you can edit it and, you know, modify the dates. So, for example, you say, okay, I don't want to give this guy access from 2013, but I want to give him access from 2016. Okay. Also, I don't want him to have my OP consultation. Things like that, you can edit. And also the consent expiry, you can edit. And here it says what all are the linked providers. Currently, we just have one. So I save the changes and I grant the consent. The concept of a consent pin, so since this is for the first time, you will have to create the consent pin. It is a 2-digit consent pin. I will say 1, 2, 3, 4. Now I have to confirm the consent pin because this is the first time. Going forward, every time you grant a consent, all you need to do is enter the consent pin once. So now here, if you go to my consent, you see this is where the granted consent is. And if the user wants, the user can revoke this consent as well. Okay. So before revoking, I'll just show that the status changed on the UI. See, this is the request initiated. It was in request initiated state on the IU UI. I'll refresh the page. Now you see it's consent granted. You can go and see the data. The same data.
Yeah, thanks, Sukrit. We'll take the last few questions and we'll close for the day. I think the core concept is understood.
Just one last thing, Kiran. As I showed on the app, you can go and revoke the consent as well. Do you want to showcase that? That's okay, I guess.
No, it's fine. I think we are out of time. It's already 30. So, folks, we'll take Sanjay first.
Yeah. No, my question is basically answered. I was just trying to understand if a consent manager has got multiple. Can you hear me?
Yes, I can hear you.
Okay. If the consent manager sees multiple records for a patient, will that be visible to HIU? And can HIU select that, okay, I want to see these 2-3 records?
No. As of now, HIU says, I want these kind of record for this user. The HIU That's doesn't it. Know where all the records are stored and where it will be coming from.
Okay. Like, for example, the doctor cannot say that, you know, what I want to see patient, you know, today the patient has come for something and I want to see only related record and not just everything, kind of. Or it is...
You can send that feedback, Sanjay. We will take a look at what additional scenarios we may need to support. Sure. Amit Samad?
Thanks, Kiran. Just a quick question. While demonstrating the PHR application, you created some test data. So will we have same flexibility to create some test data in sandbox environment or is there a separate process?
EMR web will be available. So for people building mobile apps, you can use the EMR web application, which is hosted to create some test data. And for people who are creating a HIP and a HRP, they can use the mobile application to test whether they are able to fetch and display the data. Yeah,
that's okay. Thank you.
Tools of the sandbox. Yeah.
Okay. Thank you.
Mahesh.
Yeah, Mahesh here. So in this case, the HIP initiated linking did not happen, right, from the EMR application?
No. Correct. We did not demonstrate that. It was, otherwise you would have seen an automatic notification and
on the HIP.
That on the, that's correct. Yeah. Well,
Has that been already implemented in the EMR app that is available?
It's under implementation even in our own EMR beta. That's why you don't see it.
Okay. Thank you.
Honor.
Sorry, no more questions from my side.
Yeah, thanks. Aman Verma.
Yeah, I have a question. When you initiated the linking process, it fires an API discover to the corresponding HIP.
Yes.
Yeah. Now, is there a timeout on that HIP that you got a 202 from my side? Now you will be expecting callback response.
Yes.
So is there a timeout on that?
That because it's asynchronous, the application decides on its own timeout.
But for simplicity, currently we have a timeout on the app side.
Yeah, I mean, but each app has to decide on its own timeout. That's correct. Yes.
Okay, that answers my question.
Yeah. Arun Menon?
My question is regarding that access token while we are linking the details. So when we are trying to link a detail from HIP, okay, so we'll get an access token, right?
Correct.
So does this actually identify the care context? Should we store that access token in our side, or will the consent manager be taking care of these things?
No. So you need to store. So when you do the verification of the health ID and you collect an access token from the consent manager, you need to preserve it. And whenever you are ready, so remember that usually you are collecting the access token at the point of registration of the patient many times.
Okay.
And the actual records that is available for linking may be much later because, you know, there's a treatment process and so on. So whenever you are ready to link the records or a care context, that is when you use the access token.
Okay. So all the records which is being linked by using that access token will be coming under a care context.
Yeah, the other way around, you decide what's the content of a care context. You can use an access linking token once for one care context.
Okay, thank you.
Kushan Jain, please.
Hello. So, yeah. I have two questions again. So, one first is like on the PHR application, we have seen that the patient has linked the record from a demo hospital. And post that, another HIU has requested for the same documents and the same patient record. So, is it necessary for the patient to link up the encounters of the existing hospitals and then only the HIU can fetch the records, or it can be available on request without even linking the patient record on the PHR app?
Linking is a prerequisite to sharing.
Okay. And second question is that many a times we have seen that the chronic patients are visiting the doctors, and every time they want to see the historical patient record. So maybe at that time, the patient was seeing some other hospital or the doctor. And for keeping that record for that particular HIU who wants to access the patient record, so again, he has to go through that consent part and ask for the details from the previous details of the patient through this process.
Yes, that's correct. So it depends on what you ask in the consent and what consent you get. If you have got a consent to keep the records for a few years, then there is no issue.
Okay.
Yeah, that depends on what the user is willing to share.
So in case of a patient making a booking through a HIU platform, so in that case the consent can be implicit, right? They necessarily don't have to go through the flow of adding a provider again to be able to see the record.
Yeah, we'll come cover that in a later session again, Ronak. Sohit?
Hi, Kiran. You mentioned that the health locker related APIs would be released in October. So would the release of sandbox for health lockers would be also linked to that in terms of timing, or can we expect it to be earlier?
No. Both the APIs, well, we could publish the APIs first and then the reference locker implementation next. But at this point, you should assume that likely that both will come together in first week of October.
Right. No, but my question was, so for us, the access to sandbox will also come then only, or can get an access earlier?
You will have, if you have applied, and you should be, as and when they're processing the applications, you will get your access to the sandbox.
Got it. Great. Yeah. Sure. Thanks a lot.
Tanish?
My question is around the login credentials for HIU, for the demo HIU that you guys have built. How can I get the...
it's in the documentation, Tanish. Take a look. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. Riya?
So I wanted to ask, like, if a particular doctor is treating one patient and wants to refer the patient to some other doctor in the same facility. So the process of consent form will also be repeated for the other doctor as well?
No. So see, once you are, if you are a single, let's say you have a software that is servicing a large facility, and you have already collected on behalf of the facility, you have collected the consent and you have the data, you can move it around to multiple doctors or multiple departments. That's all within your software. The consent is collected once to become available to a facility. As far as the purpose is clear, then it can be moved around internally without having to connect consents again and again. Yeah, Rohit?
Yeah, so my question was again the same. Is there such a platform for consent-based health ID access?
I am not clear about your question, Rohit.
Means for a specific health ID, let's say there are multiple health IDs. So the user can see which health ID has which, what digital records accesses.
No, you cannot see what records are associated with the health ID without user consent.
No, not me, but user can see that, right?
User can see their own records associated with each health ID. That is correct.
And where is that platform?
No. That is again an HIU itself. So, even that requires authentication and consent. So, I think you need to read up a little more to understand that concept. Manish?
Yeah. So, basically, my question was regarding the bridge access. So, we have got access and all. And we were trying to, on the third step, which is suggest that HIU to bridge and enter the mock facility registry. So I was wondering from where we can get the details for mock facility registry. Is this something which we need to do, or we will be getting those?
You just make up something like a name of a hospital, and then you just register, and in the screen that you saw in the PHR app, when you are doing a search for facility, you will be able to find that.
Okay. And just one last thing, when we click on that bridge service, it asks for username and password. So I believe
it is there. It's there in the documentation, right?
Okay, great.
Yeah,
thanks.
Yeah, my question was around the patient documents that gets stored on the health locker. Like you said, so some of the documents can be scanned and uploaded by the patient themselves, and some can be linked from the HIPs. But while providing consent, can the patient also share the documents that he has scanned and uploaded?
Yes, that's the idea of the health locker. So once the locker is there, the locker behaves as a HIP for user uploaded records. And when you're displaying such a records on the HIU side, you can show clearly to the doctor that these were user uploaded versus these were generated by a health facility.
Okay, fine. And,
we'll come to the conclusion part of this session, which is about how you can get support. So basically, we have two things. We have a devforum.ndhm.gov.in. So we'll request you to go and register on devforum, and please feel free to raise your queries on that. If there is some very specific query that you are struggling with, you can also email to ndhm.support@nha.gov.in. This email ID, by the way, is just being created, so it may take about a day or two before it goes live. And if you have not yet started on the sandbox, or if your application is not yet approved, don't worry. You will either get an email communication on what to do next. There are some applications where we will require you to reapply because the information that we have obtained is not good enough to make a decision on your application. So one of the three will happen, but pretty much the access to Sandbox is open for pretty much everyone, and we will request you to attend these webinars, understand how NDHM works, and start the overall integration process. So thank you for your time today. It was a very long session, but I hope the session was useful and productive for everyone. We will be publishing this presentation on the Sandbox site, and also we will try to put up a copy of this recording on a YouTube and put a link to that, so that in case you want to go and look at something again, you will be able to get access to that. Thank you, everyone.
Kiran, one last query.
Yeah, go ahead.
So whenever we have to send the email, do we have to mention our identity? Say, for example, I'm from Medcord, so do I have to mention Medcord so that it is easy for you to cross-check if any data validation has to happen at your end?
Yes, I think you will require to at least mention whatever is the organization name that got the access key.
Okay.
Yeah. Aditya?
So when you mentioned a facility login, I was just wondering, like, a facility can have like 10 people with, you can log in into that, few doctors, few front desk staff, and we are talking about the entire thing as a facility login, right?
Yes.
Thank you.
All right. Thank you, everyone. Thanks for your
thanks a lot. Thanks.
Thank you.
Kiran, where will you be sharing the link of the video, I mean the recording?
We will put it up on the Sandbox site. Everything will be on the Sandbox site. Yeah.
Okay. Fine. Thank you. Thank you.